that I've not heard preached on before. I'd like to find some people in the Bible that I've not heard a message on before. And so as I was reading through my Bible one time, I found out this family here, and it's a Christian couple. And we're going to talk a little bit about the kind of people that we need in our churches today. And you'll notice here in Acts chapter 18 and in verse 1, after these things, Paul departed from Athens and came to Corinth, and found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, lately come from Italy, with his wife Priscilla, because that Claudius had commanded all Jews to depart from Rome and came unto them. And because he was of the same craft, he abode with them and wrought, for by their occupation they were tent makers. Brother Tom, would you leave some word of prayer, please?
Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray now.
Help us, Lord. Help us, Father.
Father, I pray that you touch Brother Lince, Father.
Yes.
The Holy Spirit, how it works through the Word of God. Father, I pray that those who would not
thank help us.
Everything else going on today, Father, that the hearts and minds will be on this message. We thank you for it. We pray in the name of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now, I found out reading my Bible that there's a lot of things in here that I just kind of skip over. Now, sometimes I read my Bible, but I really don't read my Bible. Have you ever done that before? I do that quite often. But every once in a while, I'll come across the great truth in the Bible. And boy, if I ever found one, it's right here. And it's this Christian couple. Their names are Aquila and Priscilla. Now, that may not seem a lot to you, but boy, that thing got a hold of me, and I began to study out what was so peculiar about this Christian couple, Aquila and Priscilla. Well, I looked up what their names meant, and Aquila meant an eagle. That's the man. He's the soaring high. And then the Priscilla meant she was a little ancient one. That might have meant she was a little bit old-fashioned instead of this ERA type of woman. I mean, she didn't go out there and make those biscuits. I mean, she kneaded that dough down there with that old dough and that old water and got that yeast going. And then she made biscuits for her husband. Now, he may have had a little bulge around the middle, but he was a happy husband. He wasn't worried about those biscuits. And unto God tonight, if you make those things, there's something wrong tonight. I mean, learn how to cook tonight. That's what us men like. We like to eat, amen. But she was an ancient one. I mean, she believed in cleaning the house, and she believed in and fixing herself up, and she believed in watching the kids, and I mean, she believed in the things that the old-fashioned women believe in. And boy, I'll tell you today, us men ain't looking for a new jet-age type woman. Let me say now, if you're not married tonight, don't you find you some Jaguar type-looking girl. I mean, find yourself a Volkswagen. I mean, one that'll keep on keeping on, no matter what they look like. I mean, keep on going, for God. You get one of those Jaguars, and next thing you know, some slick thing will come by and steal her from you. That's not what you want. Amen? Now, once in the Word of God, Paul used a nickname, and he called her in 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 19, he called Priscilla Prisca. Now, I don't know exactly what the meaning of that thing was, but I know one thing. If Paul knew this Christian couple as close as I think he did by using a nickname, that shows me that they had an intricate Christian relationship with the pastor. And here's old Paul. He's getting together with these folks, and they're doing the same work he's doing, which is tent making. So they're getting together, and they're learning about each other, and they're ministering together, and they're working together, and that's exactly what you and I are supposed to do as a Christian tonight. Boy, we got a bunch of Christians, you know, just want to fight, and just like an old tomcat just looking for something to scratch. But I don't like that type of Christian tonight. I want somebody that can help me, and somebody that I can help. Now, I found some things about Aquila and Priscilla. First of all, I found this out, that they were a strong Christian couple. Every time in the Bible that Aquila's mentioned, Priscilla is mentioned. And every time Priscilla's mentioned, Aquila's mentioned. Every time in the Bible that one of these folks is mentioned, the other one's right with them. And if we're ever lived in a day when couples are being spread apart and pushed apart, it's today. Daddy works a day shift, mama works a night shift, and the kids just shift and do anything they want to. And that is not according to the Word of God tonight. I'll tell you what, if you're a strong Christian couple, and if you love your husband, and if husband, if you love your wife, you are just about on the endangered species as far as this world goes tonight. But I'll tell you what will build a strong church, and I'll tell you what will shake this community tonight, is some good Christian couples that will serve Jesus Christ and be faithful according to the Word of God. That's what we need today. You'll notice that Aquila and Priscilla, when they're mentioned, they're together. Now, I know a lot of jokes, you know, about marriages. And I've heard all the jokes, you know, about the man, how mighty he is, and heard about all the jokes about how stupid the women are, you know. But I'm sick and tired of hearing jokes about marriages. Because I don't think a marriage is a joking thing tonight. I think it's ordained in the Word of God, and I think we ought to strengthen our marriages. And instead of, you know, some of you men tonight, under God, you know, I got these wild fellas down at church, and they're wild. I got this one guy, and we pulled him out from underneath some rock up there on some mountain, you know, and he's just an old mountain boy. And he got saved, and I said, he said, "Brother Jim, I want to do something for God." And I said, "Well, pray, and God will tell you what to do, Chris." And so he came in, he had kind of a little feathery hair, you know, kind of feathering over top his ear, you know. And I said, "Well," I said, "why don't you just go ahead and cut your hair?" And he said, "Okay." He came in with his head, it was shaved. He said, "What do you think?" I said, "Well, I guess it's all right." And he said, "But I still want to do something for God." I said, "Pray. God will tell you what to do for him." I said, "Just pray." He came in one Wednesday night, Brother Greg. He was sitting in the front row, and everybody behind him was squealing and laughing. All the fellows was leaning up against the wall. I said, "What did he do now?" I said, "Oh, no, what did this boy do?" So I walked over there by those other fellows, and they were pointing at Brother McNeely, and this guy's got 10 different black belts in karate. He's about 6'4", and he's about 270 pounds, and he has got no fat on him. This is just what you call a big boy. And I looked behind him, and on the back of his head where he had his head shaved, his wife is a beautician, and she carved "Jesus Saves" on the back of that thing. Whoa! I didn't know what to do. I began to laugh. The worst thing was he came to my office, and he said, "Brother Jim, what do you think?" I said, "I don't know." He said, you think that's of God?" I said, "I don't know." He said, "As surely as radical as you are, Brother Jim, you would do it, wouldn't you?" I said, "Man, I'm Diotrephes. I like the preeminent." I said, "I'm too proud to do something like that." That old boy got his feelings hurt. Well, he let it grow back out, but he wanted to do something for God. I seen him coming again. "Turn or burn." That's what he had. I said, "Say, what did you say?" "Hey, he's 6'4", 270 pounds. I didn't say nothing, amen. I seen that boy take his leg and shoot it straight up in the air while he was talking to me. I ain't going to say nothing to him. But you know what? After a process of time, that old boy began to grow. And after a process of time, he began to not be so mean to his wife. You know how they are when they first get saved and when they're still infant Christians. You know how men are when they get saved. They got to think that they're the big muscle man, you know. So what they do is they embarrass their wives at church, you know. "Sit down and you shut up and don't say a word until I tell you to. You know, don't say amen, don't say nothing. You just sit down there and be submissive to me." Well, if she had something to be submissive to, she might be submissive to you, amen. But that's the problem today in Christianity. And boy, I see it over and over again. We think that we're not a Bible-believing, militant Christian unless, you know, we're the big hard guy on our wives. That shows that you're unbiblical. It also shows that you're immature in your Christian walk tonight. Amen. Not Paul, not Aquila and Priscilla, amen? I don't believe you've got to mistreat your wife to be a Bible believer, amen? Listen, I got married some 16 years ago, and if Jesus tarries for another 16 years, I'm staying with the one I got, amen? I know there's some problems, and I know there's some ways in and out of marriage. I know all that stuff. I pastor a church, and I know that God can forgive you, and you can be used just as much as you'll yield to God if you have problems or not. I know all that stuff, but the biblical principle is one man for one woman, amen? And instead of just switching like you do a new car or getting another one like you get a new suit or a new dress, you ought to learn to build that family biblically for God Almighty tonight. And if you're not, then you're cockeyed. Amen. Now, one stupid saint told me one time, he's at our church too, he's just a character. He said, "You know what women are for?" I said, "No, I don't want to tell you. Enlighten me with your biblical ignorance." He said, "I'll tell you what they're for." He said, "They're for the bedroom and they're for the kitchen. That's it." I said, "Next time you see your wife, it'll be down at the courthouse and you'll be getting divorced." That Bible says that your wife is a help meet. She's to help you out. And I found this out. Behind every good man, usually there's a good woman. So, oh, you never read John Wesley. I did too. I read about John Wesley. When, hey, I got that second wife, and that woman used to go up there and touch me and everything. They didn't tell you about the first one, did it? She's your help. And she's to help you out, and you ought to stop beating her down like most Christians do. Amen. But here, the old Aquila and Priscilla, they're a very strong Christian couple. Now, you know, we got some problems in our Christian society today. A lot of people pay more attention to their kids than they do to their spouse. That's wrong. That shows you that your marriage, there's something wrong in the Geiger counter of your love and your marriage. A lot of women pay more attention to their kids. Daddies pay more attention to their kids than they do their wife. That's wrong tonight. Some of you men pay more attention to your buddies than you do your wife. You know, your wife says, honey, can we go out? You know, I know you've been busy all week and you've been working. You think maybe we scraped up a little money. Maybe we could go out to dinner or something and have a good time. You know, take the kids out and get dressed up. And I mean, go out there and have a good time. And you say, oh, honey, I can't do it. I've been so tired. And boy, I've been working all week. And I've been trying to study my Bible. And I'm getting ready for it to go to church, you know. And I just don't think I can do it, honey. So she graciously bows out and says, okay. 5 minutes later, your buddy calls up on the phone. Hey, we're going to have a splat gun contest down here in about 25 minutes. Do you think you can make it? Yes, sir, brother, I'll be right there. Don't you worry. Honey, get my camis and get my gun, and we're going, and don't forget the glasses. Something wrong with you. So how did you know we had splat gun contests? They all told me about it, amen. Some pay more attention to their kin than they do to their own mother or their own husband and wife. That's wrong, amen. Don't die on me now. Now, the Lord always addresses the woman first. Now, let's see how strong your Christian couple is. According to the Word of God, we have duties to perform to one another. The wife has duties to me. I have duties to my wife. If she's not fulfilling hers, she's wrong. If I'm not fulfilling mine, I'm wrong. But I know one thing. When they're fulfilling the duties and they're ministering to each other, there ain't nothing happier on this earth today than a Christian family. I don't care what anybody says. There's all the money in the world. Can't buy it. There ain't nothing that can buy the love of a Christian home tonight. Now here's yours, ladies. You're to obey your husband. 1 Peter 3, 5, and 6. You're to obey him. You're to reverence him. Ephesians chapter 5. And boy, I'll tell you, I've seen some women do that. I've seen some guys be so rude and crude in front of their brethren, you know, to make them look big in front of that wife, and that wife just hush and just keep her mouth quiet and reverence them. God don't have to have her speak. You done already made a fool of yourself. Now, she may open it up once you get in the car, but at least she's got enough God about her to shut up in the church house. It'd do some of you good to learn that from her. Amen. Amen. Don't die on me. Please don't die on me. All right, now listen. You're to learn from him. You're to learn from your husband. Spiritual things. 1 Timothy 2. You're to be faithful unto your husband. Amen. You're to be chaste. That's to be pure in character. And you're to be innocent in your conduct tonight. Then you're to be a keeper of the home. And when you're in submission to your husband, it makes your husband strong. It does. When a woman is not in submission to her husband, the Bible says you're either his crown or your rottenness to his bones. And when you obey your husband, and when you submit yourself unto your husband, he gets to thinking he's a pretty good Christian. And he'll start acting like one. You ever see your husband when you treat him right, and you feed him right, and no biscuits like that, but knead him out, you know? And I mean, you're submissive to your husband, and everything's going pretty good. Well, he gets up in the morning, and man, he begins to beat his chest. He feels like him King Kong, and he's going to go out there, do something for God. But if you don't, boy, he's a drooping, and he's a moping around, eating cold cereal, you know. I mean, this guy's having a hard time, isn't it? Now, according to the Word of God, there's also some duties for you husbands. You're to love your wife. How? As Christ loved the church. And he gave himself for it. I had a friend. One time, this guy was a nut. I went over to his house, and we was doing something over there, and we'd be sitting down at the table, and he'd go, I thought he had indigestion. Because every time he did that, his wife came over there, laid a coffee cup down there, and poured hot coffee, and walked away. About 20 minutes later, she run over there. I thought, this guy's got indigestion problems. He got stomach problems or something. I don't know what's going on. And he said, you want a cup of coffee? I said, sure. And he said, and poured that thing on it. If I was that woman, and I'd sold Irish German got up in me, I swear to God, I'd have poured it right in his lap. The third time he went, What's wrong with a man like that tonight? Just thinking that that's a slave, that ain't a slave, that's your help me tonight. And you're the lover as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. A lot of Christian men like that. Amen. 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 You're to render unto her due benevolence. You're to teach her spiritual things. She is the weaker vessel. You're to take care of her. Amen. And I believe tonight, according to the Word of God, the man's to be the breadwinner. Amen. I mean, get out there and work and work and work and try to supply some. My daddy had to work 2 and 3 jobs to raise us 7 kids. But when I fell down and busted my knee, I didn't have to go see a daycare keeper. I didn't have to go see anybody else. There was Mama. Mama was 5 foot by 5 foot. You say, what was she? She was a cube, amen. But boy, when she put those arms around you, about as big as my thigh here, Mama put those arms around you and pulled her into you, you knew what Mama was all about, amen. I didn't have to have one of these Jaguars. I had me a Mack truck, amen. But when that Mack truck hugged you, praise God, you knew that Mama was there, amen. I believe the husband ought to be the breadwinner tonight and bring home the bacon, don't you? Something wrong with a woman. Something wrong with a woman that she doesn't love her children, amen? Now, some of the problems I've seen with Christian couples is this. They don't put God first in everything. They won't put God first. Oh, they'll put Him first in a few things, but not in everything. And I found out that once you put God first in everything, everything else just kind of floats right along in order. But if you don't, it won't work out, folks. I'm telling you the truth.
Right.
Then I found this out. That you're a lot of big trouble with most Christians. I know not here in Ohio, but down in North Carolina we have them like this. Not being one in purpose. They're not working together to do something for God. And if you're not working one in purpose, the thing ain't going to get done. It's like drawing each other apart. I tell you, it's hard. You know, and I know some of you folks, all these little kids here, and it's hard to raise kids today, ain't it? Especially under the microscope of King James independent premillennial Bible believing Christians. Now what the preacher's kids will do, you'll look at him that way under the microscope, but boy, you'll have the widest view about your kids you've ever had. Amen?
Yeah,
but when he gets up here and begins to shuck the corn, you'll say, who in the world does he think he is? That man and that woman's got to be one in purpose. Sometimes my wife will say, this boy needs the fire beat out of him. And I'll say, what did he do? And she'll tell me. And you know what I got to do? I got to beat the fire out of him.
Yeah, amen.
That little boy, I know he's only 9. I love him. Good night, I love him. But sometimes he'll try to get Mama here and Daddy here. He'll try to get Mama to work against Daddy. And Daddy to work against Mama. You know who the boss is then? It ain't Daddy. It ain't Mama. It's him.
Yeah.
And boy, you ever see a kid run anything? Just look at our government. It ain't going to do good, amen. That's right. I found this out, too. Christian couples don't fellowship together. They don't fellowship together. You boys run out with the boys, you know, and have a good fellowship. You girls go out with the girls, have a good fellowship. You come home from church, you sit there and look at each other. Like a goat looks at a new gate. Just sit there and look at that thing. You don't fellowship together. Don't fellowship around the Word of God together. Don't fellowship around just being yourselves together. So why, when we was dating, boy, we talked and talked and talked and talked and talked. Now that you got her, what's the matter? Can't you keep up the talk? You used to talk, boy, when you didn't have her. Some of you fellas, you got pretty wives as ugly as you are. You must have been a good talker too, amen. That's right. What's the matter? How come you can't talk no good now? I found this out, something wrong with Christians too. Hebrews chapter 13, the Bible says marriage is honorable and all the bed under five. Sometimes they don't perform the marital rites. It's wrong. Did you ever see over there in 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 1 through 5? You ever read that over there? It says not to defraud yourself, one from another. You know what defraud means? It means to hold back. That's what it means. So that's getting pretty plain. That ain't plain as the television you watched last night.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
that ain't plain at all. I mean, you want to get plain, we'll get plain, amen. You come down to my church and I'll get real plain with you. I'm in his church now. When you don't do that, the Bible says, unless be given for a season, lest Satan tempt you for your inconsistencies. You ever read that passage over there? You know what's going to happen? You don't get together with your husband, you don't get together with your wife and have that marital congenial right, you know what's going to happen? The devil's going to send somebody their way.
Right.
He's going to send a man over there to sweet-talk that woman, and that woman's going to say, hey, my husband's always telling me I'm too fat. I'm getting sloppy. Well, have you looked at him lately? He ain't the same after 20 years either. You ever see what happens to men? Men, some men get bloated in the belly, but they lose hair on top of their heads. Then they begin to grow it in their ears and grow it out their nose. Amen. Strangest thing. You know you're getting old when it comes out your ears and it's coming out your nose. I'm 40 years old. I didn't ever think anything coming out my nose. I'll be shaving and see great big old hair. Look like a spider. What's up in there? I'll be looking up in the mirror. I think big old daddy long leg crawling up my nose or something. Hair coming out. And then it looks like there's carrots down in my ears. My mama said, carrots. Hey, carrots grew in my head. Didn't have to come out my ears. But I mean, big old hairs are shooting out like that. You don't look as good as you used to either. Well, as a matter of fact, if your wife told you the truth, she'd tell you he's the pure Pillsbury Doughboy. Amen. Amen. A lot of folks say, well, Brother Jim, they come talk to me, you know, the spark isn't there no more. That's stupid stuff.
Yeah.
You know what that spark was? That spark was youthful lust. And now that you've got mature adult love, you don't want that anymore. You want something that's lustful and ungodly tonight to turn your flesh on tonight, and it's wrong tonight. I'd rather have mature love to where I know my wife, and I know she loves me, and she loves God Almighty tonight. And bless God, that's what you need to get back in your marriage tonight. Always looking for something to just thrill the flesh and things like that. It's wrong. Amen? I had folks come up, I don't want my wife no more. I don't want my husband no more. Crazy world we're living in. I found this out. They're a good Christian couple. They're always together. But just because they're with Paul doesn't make them a good Christian couple. There's a lot of good Christian couples in a lot of good churches this morning. And then there's a lot of couples in good Bible-believing, sound churches this morning that have not got a good marriage. So just being hooked up with an organization, that won't make you a good Christian couple. Look down here in verse 18. Watch this. So the biblical principles of a marriage will last for a lifetime if you apply the Bible to your lifetime. Look at chapter 18, verse 18. Watch this. And Paul, after this, tarried yet a good while, and then took his leave of the brethren and sailed thence into Syria, and with him Priscilla and Aquila, having shown his head in Caesarea, for he had a vow. You know what the Bible says there? First of all, to make this good Christian couple, they had to be sold out to each other. Second of all, you notice in that verse it says that they were with Paul. They were with him. I found this out. You want to keep your family going to good together? Be with that preacher right there. You got to be with him. But I found this out. You can't be with the preacher until you got your marriage right. That preacher will preach on something, that woman will be going home, I ain't going back to hear that bald-headed preacher again. He says that stuff again like that, I ain't going back to hear him again. We'll go down the road here somewhere. We'll go down here where I don't have to listen to this type of preaching. The husband will say, oh honey, hush now, you know, oh honey, I'll buy you a steak, you know, oh honey. Don't cause me any trouble, I'm going to the Bible Institute, oh honey, be quiet now. If that marriage ain't right, your authority that you stand underneath of, you'll begin to crumble the authority in that pulpit because your marriage ain't right. That's a good God encounter. Amen. That's good preaching, Brother Jim. I thought it was. Amen. That's a thing that's hurting more churches than I know. A family or a couple that won't back their pastor. These folks would do it. You said, well, Brother Jim, I believe the Bible. If you did, you believe in pastoral authority. Amen. Every church I've been in, I was in Brother Noah's church for a while, Dr. Ruckman's church for a while, another boy's church for a while, I did what that fellow told me to do. I wasn't responsible whether I agreed or disagreed. I was responsible to do what I was told tonight. Amen. And I didn't always agree. I found out if everybody's agreeing, no one's thinking. I didn't agree going to Vietnam, but I went because I was a Marine. I didn't agree having to walk out in the rice paddies and pick leeches off men and wear a radio on my back. I didn't agree with that either. I didn't want to I didn't agree when I got shrapnel in my legs. I didn't agree with that either. But somebody higher than me told me to do it, so I did it tonight. And when your pastor tells you to do something, you ought to do it tonight if you want to be a good Christian couple to where God can use you. You notice they were with Paul and Paul's labors. They were with Paul and Paul's praying. They were with Paul when Paul got to preaching and teaching and working. I mean, they backed Paul's ministry. Even when Paul got a little controversial, and don't you think Paul didn't get controversial, boy. I mean, when he started kicking those folks in Acts chapter 17 at Athens and preached the unknown God, Aquila and Priscilla was there saying, preach it, Paul, preach it, Paul, preach it, Paul. I mean, preach it, Paul. Let's get out and get going. He got out there in those streets and began to preach. He began to kick all the religious crowd. They didn't say, we better go back to First Baptist where we evolved from. I mean, let's go back to a lot of church. They said, go, Paul, go, 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 Paul, and keep on preaching. They was with them. Boy, how would you like to have been with Priscilla and Aquila when Paul got stirred up? How would you like to have been that fellow that was handcuffed to Paul all the way to Rome? How would you like to have been that fellow? I mean, a Roman centurion gets in there to Rome and Paul gets stirred up. Woo! Praise God, you bunch of idolaters! You bunch of Baalistic priests! You're all going to hell! You're going to hell! You're going to hell! Way back in the distance you hear, amen. Amen. Well, Paul turns around, there's Priscilla and Aquila. They're with him. They're with him. Well, that's a good one. Amen. It's the kind that'll build a church. Amen. You must understand, we got to believe the Bible around here. And I found this out. I heard it somewhere along the line that you can tell how people think of you by the way their kids respond to you. I use their children in the church that I pastor to see how the folks are treating, how they're talking about me at home. And boy, it'll come out, man. It'll come out. And you know this one girl, she skips around to come to church, and she'll be in my wife's Sunday school class, and that little girl come in there and say, "Mama was too tired to come to church this morning. She thought the preacher would preach too long this morning." Boy, that's good, amen? Because I got a gaga counter there. Kind of like my little nephew. His name is Casey. And Casey's he's a bad boy. He's not saved. He's a bad boy. But his mama's about this tall, and she's a little Italian girl. They live up here in Detroit. And up in Detroit, you know, they have a lot of black folk up there. And she said she went down to, this kid's always saying something he shouldn't say. And they went down to the grocery store there, and they went up in the grocery line there, and there was this great big old black woman there. And my sister-in-law said she looked like a spitting image of Aunt Jemima. I mean, she was just a big one, you know. I mean, you could hardly tell the neck that sat on the shoulders. It was just sitting there, you know. Just a big old girl, you know. And Casey started saying, "Mama." He's about 2 years old. He said, "Mama." She said, "Hush, Casey, hush, hush." He said, "But Mama." She said, "Casey, shut up." She said that boy started getting afraid. "Mama! Mama! Mama!" She said, "Christian, shut up, I'll whoop you." He said, "But Mama! Mama! Mama, it's King Kong! It's King Kong! It's King Kong!" Yeah. And just about the time you get to fussing and discussing the preacher, you'll come up there and you'll be your old pious Judas Iscariot self, you know. "Hello, Brother East Step Iron, we having a good sir. And Daddy, is this the one you was talking about? Is this the one you said is preaching too hard? Daddy, is this the one? Is this the one?" It'll come out when you ain't with that preacher. Amen? Telling the truth now.
Amen.
Amen. Paul, he preached. And he didn't even mind. These folks didn't even mind when he got to roasting them. They just said, "Oh, amen or oh me." Amen? You notice he didn't say, "always agree," like I said, but they was with the preacher. Look in verse 24 or something else. Now, first of all, for this was a great Christian couple, they had to have their marriage straightened out. Then they had to be straight with the preacher. They had to be with the preacher. That's step number two. In verse 24, you'll look at step number three in a Christian life. "And a certain Jew named Apollos, born of Alexandria, an eloquent man and mighty in the Scriptures, came to Ephesus. This man was instructed in the way of the Lord, and being fervent in the Spirit, he spake and taught diligently the things of the Lord, knowing only the baptism of John." Now, if these folks got their marriage right, they're backing their preacher, the next thing that happens in a good Christian family is that they help other people out that doesn't have as much light on the Bible as they have. But you can't do that until your own home's straightened out. You can't help somebody out until you're with the preacher. I've had folks before come to our church, you know, they come from these Bible schools, you know, and they know so much Bible, good enough, the Holy Ghost would have to ask them questions if he had to rewrite the Bible. And what they'll do is they'll say, "How about you and you and you and you and you and you come on over Friday night? And when you come over Friday night, I'm going to teach you the Bible." But he ain't with the pastor. And it's you go over there to get the Bible taught to you, and his kids is climbing up the curtains, you know, and running all over the house, you know. And that don't work no more. Amen. Hello, as we say downtown. Paul was busy, see. Paul was busy preaching the gospel and writing epistles, but when he was so busy where he couldn't get some things done, he had a Christian couple in that church where he had Aquila and Priscilla would go out there and nurture and minister to younger Christians that didn't know as much Bible as Paul had taught them underneath his ministry. Boy, that's what a church needs this morning. Amen. Look at down there in verse 28. "And he mightily convinced the Jews and that publicly showing by the Scriptures that Jesus was Christ." Usually the ones that are always worried and burdened about everybody falling are the only ones that are talking and griping and complaining about what the preacher's preaching. Amen? Now, they didn't take the truth that Paul gave them either and sit on it. A lot of Christians do that. You know, us as King James Bible believers, you know we lose the vision of lost souls. I found this out. Man, I look at that mission board. That's wonderful, brother. That is. That's absolutely wonderful. But that's all in vain if you can't pass out tracts. Who is up there in Livonia? And they said, "Our church gives $180,000, $150,000, and all this." And I said, "Hey, are you just paying somebody else to witness for you so you can be excused, or are you doing it yourself?" A lot of folks just want to pay somebody else to do it. I believe in this, man, I do. And man, we're going to get more involved. And boy, I look at that board there, and it just makes me cry tonight. But listen, we as a husband and wife team can still win people to Jesus Christ. You want to have something good to do? Get yourself a couple hundred tracts apiece and go out on a date. Sweet talk her while she's eating, and get her a nice big dinner, and then go out there and pass out a bunch of tracts for Jesus Christ. What a blessing. Heard it, they went right over here to Apollos and said, "Apollos, This fellow, he's fervent. He's got some zeal. Might be zeal on fire, or might be knowledge on ice, but he's got some zeal here. And he said, but he only knows the baptism of John. So I'm going to straighten him out. You can meet a charismatic at work, and the guy's kooky as a bed bug. And they're kooky. Aren't they kooky folk? They're really strange. And all these feelings, you know, and all this stuff coming down on them. And you could say, hey, brother, why don't you come on over to the house? Bring your family over. Amen. Get them a nice dinner, sit down, start talking about the Bible with them. Say, man, you ought to hear our preacher. Man, you ought to hear our preacher preach. I mean, that guy can preach. I mean, even if it was a dead service, just go in there and just tell, man, that's the greatest service you ever heard in your life. Promote that, man. Promote them as a husband and wife team. Amen. Amen. Boy's dying now, eh? Amen. You notice that their main concern was for people that didn't have as much light as they had. Boy, that I like that. Amen? That's the kind of people you need in your church. You know what the Bible says? It tells us to be kindly affected one toward another in Romans 12. We as Christians are to be affected one towards another. We're to have affections one of another. I got to see my daddy up there in Detroit. He's retired now and he lives up there. And you know what? There's not a whole lot of affections there because my dad doesn't love Jesus Christ. He's saved, but he doesn't really serve the Lord. But boy, when I got around some folks I hadn't seen in 10 years, and I hadn't seen them, and I seen them in 10 years. But they're the same type of people that they was 10 years ago. And boy, those boys would come up to me and hug me, and I'd hug them, and boy, we'd get to talking about the things of God. I mean, tonight, we're to have affections one towards another tonight in the house of God. Amen? Not only that, we're to prefer one another in love, the Bible says, Romans 10, or 12 and verse 10. Prefer one another. That's kind of, if you're in the steakhouse line and they only got one piece of cheesecake left, let your buddy have it. If you got something your brother can use, let him have it. That's preferring one another in love. Boy, I like that. You know what happened to me? One time I went down to this, we got a shoot boot outlet down, down below us a little bit down the mountains. And you can buy old good Dan Post Abilene boots for about $50, but they're seconds. I went down there and found me a black pair of cowboy boots. Man, I liked them. And this boy that was with me, he said, he wears the same size I do. And he said, Brother Jim, he said, man, I've been looking for those boots. And I found them. Man, I dug through all the boxes. You know, I found those boots. I said, Lord, thank God, I got me a black pair now. I only got about five other pairs, but I got me a black pair now. Kind of like some of you women, I need another pair of shoes. When you open up the closet, and they pile you down, you know. And he said, Brother Jim, I've been looking for those boots for a long time. So I went over there, I sat them down, and I tried those boots on, boy, and they fit just perfect, you know. And I said, man, I think I'll get these. And he said, man, I've been looking for a pair of boots like that for a long time. And I said, well, brother, you should have got in the pile before I did. And the Holy Ghost said, hey, boy. Oh, yeah. There he is. I said, come on, Lord. He ain't a preacher. He's just going to walk out in that old pig manure, cow manure, and don't get those boots all cruddy. I mean, use them for something good, God. God said, you give them to him. I said, I ain't going to do it, Lord. I got me a new gray suit. I got to have those boots for him, see. Lord said, boy, you give those boots to him. And he's sitting there, and I said, Ronnie, I said, go ahead and take those boots, man. He said, woo! See, we're emotional down there. Right in the shoe store. Woo! Praise God, amen. He grabbed and went up there, boy, that's hot. It wasn't more blessed to give that day. I got old 68 Ford pickup truck. If you've seen it run, you'd wonder how it's running. I drive up and down those mountains and do everything, hunting, fishing. And I got out there, I was going to go someplace, you know, the next morning it was cold out there. And in my front seat, I've got those steel saws and hammers and levels and just everything in that thing. Tarps and everything else. I got in there and I started up that old truck, you know, and it was blah, 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 you know, going like crazy. And pull the choke out to make it run, push the choke in, you know, and I was thinking, boots. You know, here's Ron. He works across the street. He's waving at me. I'm thinking, yeah, boots. You think I'm a good guy? My heart's filthy as can be. See, I want those boots. And I come home from work and go out the next day and come in, same thing, here he is. I came in there, it was on a Saturday, and I went to go someplace, and I looked down on the floorboard, and you know what there was there? A box. And it said Abilene on it. And I thought, I know what that devil did. He put his old dirty box in my truck. I went over and opened up that box, and there was these boots I got on right here. Black pair of boots. And they're nicer than the ones that he got. So I went over and I said, Ronnie! What'd you do with those boots? He said, I kept them. What do you think I did?
It wasn't him. I still ain't found out who gave me the boots.
So if somebody wants a pair of boots, let them have them, amen. But we're to be kindly affected. We're to prefer one another. We're to be like-minded one toward another. We're to receive one another. We're to edify one another. We're to love one another. And then turn your Bible to Isaiah chapter 41. Boy, I want to show you something this morning. We'll hurry up. But in Isaiah chapter 41, we're to do something for the brethren. Amen? And if you're a strong Christian couple, you'll be doing this for the brethren tonight. You'll be working together as a Christian couple. Or you'll be with the preacher. Then you'll be helping folks out that aren't as spiritual as you are. And I'm sure that won't be hard to find. Amen? Now you notice in Isaiah chapter 41, here's something that we lack to do. Look at verse 6. They helped everyone his neighbor, and everyone said to his brother, be of good courage. So the carpenter encouraged the goldsmith. And he that smootheth with the hammer, him that smote the anvil, saying, it is ready for the soldering, and he fastened it with the nails, that it should not be moved. You know what's going on here with Aquila and Priscilla? They're going over there and saying, brother, that was good preaching there when you got to preach one time. Praise God, that was real good, man. That was good. I mean, man, you did a good job. And you walk over to this sister teaching your kids at Sunday school, and your kids come home with those little drawings, and they've been blessed at Sunday school, and telling you about Sunday school. You say, sister, that was a real blessing there, teaching that class. And then my kids are really learning the Bible. You know what that does? That begins to build that family and that church of God, and you begin to encourage each other. And boy, it'll be a blessing to you when you do it tonight. But it's missing in most of our churches tonight. You go up to the preacher, you know, you shake his hand. I mean, he's just raked you across the coals, and he's beat you with the belt, and he's thrown salt on top of that, and then he stood back and laughed at you, you know, and told you need to get right with God. And boy, you came up and cried your heart out. And boy, when you walk out, your hands are still sweaty, and you walk past the preacher like you don't want to talk to him. You ought to go up there and say, brother, I've needed it. I appreciate it. Boy, I love that preaching. I mean, keep it up, keep it up, keep it up. I need to get right with God. And bless God, if you get any softer, we're going to start booing you and say amen in you, preacher. But preach the Word of God to us tonight. Boy, that'll change that preacher's life. Amen. We have something else. In 1 Corinthians 16, we won't turn there. In Romans 16:19, they were a blessing to the local assembly that Paul started. Now you notice that they had to have their marriage right. Then they had to have, be with the pastor. Then they had to have the right burden to help other people, and then they were a blessing to the other people in the church. Now when Paul started these local assemblies, at times they didn't have a place to meet in. So you know where they met at? Aquila and Priscilla's house. They said, if we ain't got no place else to meet, praise God, come out of our house. We don't care what's going on. We'll straighten it up, we'll clear it out, and we'll meet there and worship God Almighty. Well, I like that. You know how you can make people want to come back to your house? You greet them when they come. Someone come to my house, I say, hey, brother, come on in. Hey, sister, come on in. Open up the door and let them come in. This is a pretty good church on that. I come in here this morning, probably shook about 20, 30 hands. Folks come up, hello, how are you doing? Good to have you here. That's a blessing. That shows that God's doing something here. Then when they're here, you make them feel comfortable. Someone come to your house, you don't make them stand in the corner. Do you? Good night, I don't. I say, come on over here, sit in the best chair. Sit down. Well, can I get you something to drink? Are you hungry? Can I do something for you? That's exactly what you ought to do in the church house here tonight. And then when they leave, you know what you say? You say, come on back. We say, y'all come back. You want them to come back, see? And boy, when you start inviting people back, these little chairs here that's not filled up, they'll start getting filled up because they know there's a church that's not only radical in King James, but there's also a church in this area that's got a love for Jesus Christ and a love for people. Amen. Amen. So they were a blessing. And that's what makes great churches. They were a blessing with their presence. They were a blessing in their participation. They were a blessing with their biblical principles in their lives. They were a blessing because they propagated the church that they went to. They were a blessing because they prayed for the churches that the church that they was at. And they used their talents at that church. You know, if God hadn't given me a pastorate, you know what I'd do? Even being called to preach, you know what I'd do? I'd sit underneath a man that could teach me the Bible like that man taught this morning. You folks are downright spoiled. You get down here below the Mason-Dixon line, good night. They still think angels have wings, everything. I mean, these folks are crazy, man. They take an experience and a feeling over the Word of God. I heard that man teach this morning, you folks are spoiled, rotten. Someone get up there and just lay that Bible out, man, and teach that Bible like that. You sit down and write down notes. Boy, you got it good. Amen. Boy, if I was in a church like this, I'd go out there and I'd tell them that. I'd tell them. Boy, I'd tell them. Amen.
Amen.
So they were a blessing because they used their times, their talents, and their treasures to that local assembly. Now, are you a blessing to Charity Baptist Church? Are you a blessing to Charity Baptist Church? Can this church operate the way it ought to every Sunday if you're not here? Or can it just go just like it always does? If you're Aquila and Priscilla instead of Ananias and Sapphira. See, Ananias and Sapphira, when they ain't there, the church can just roll on. But when Aquila and Priscilla aren't there, the preacher says, where are they at this morning? Did they get somebody to teach our Sunday school? Oh, goodness. Did they talk about it? Did they talk to my wife? Did they talk to somebody? Where are they at this morning? And when we come down, back down to where chicken scratches, are you an Aquila and Priscilla of this church? Say, well, Brother Jim, I'm not called to preach. I didn't say that. I said, are you a help to this church? Back in 1829, there was a little girl born to a rich family in Derbyshire, England. Her name was Kathleen. In 1829, there was a boy by the name of William born to a very poor family in Limpshire, England. A rich family had a girl. Poor family had a boy, miles apart. About 25 years later, they met and they got married. And when they got married, they took this Bible and they said, whatever God can do with us as a unit, a husband and wife, will give the glory to God Almighty. And this little Kathleen, who was from a rich family, and old poor William, became one of the greatest couples in all church history. Started a thing called the Salvation Army. William Booth, Kathleen Booth. They used to get out there with those derelicts, you know, drunks and stuff, and get that yellow and red flag called Thunder, Fire and Thunder, and get out there and just let her rip. And when old Katie Booth died, there was more people that came to her funeral than there was to Queen Anne. You say, why? Because they was a blessed couple, according to the Word of God. They took their marriage and they said, God, whatever comes out of it, whatever we can do as a husband and wife to serve you, we'll do it for the glory and honor of Jesus Christ. And they did. So the question this morning is, what kind of couple are you? Are you an Aquila and Priscilla? Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Aquila and Priscilla, not mentioned much in the Bible. By far. Not mentioned much. But they was a strong Christian couple. They was with the preacher, Paul. They helped others out. Then there's a blessing to that local assembly. Let me ask you a question this morning, folks. All heads bowed and eyes closed. Instruments played a little bit low. When you're not here, does it hurt Charity Baptist Church? Is your family straight? Are you with the preacher? Have you got a burden to help people out that are stumbling? Are you a blessing to this church? Husband and wife, listen. You want to be used by God? Why don't you come together this morning? Just get out of that seat together and say, God, bless our family. Whatever comes out of it, God, we'll do it for your glory. Won't you come this morning before we pray? Won't you come? Just husband and wife. Come on. Come on. Just say, God, whatever we can do to help this preacher. God, whatever we can do to help this church. God, whatever we can do to bring glory and honor to God Almighty. You just come this morning, pour out your heart to God. Let God mold you into an Aquila and Priscilla for Him. Come on. Won't you come? That's right. Come on. Be somebody for God Almighty. Just get up and come. Say, well, I'll do it in my seat. I know, but God wants to see you move. God likes to see you move. Be with the preacher. Be with him and back him. And I mean, bless God, just back him as far as you can go. And God will bless you. Won't you come? Won't you come with these others this morning? That's right. Say, God, make me. Make me an Aquila and a Priscilla. Keep our heads bowed, and these folks are praying this morning. Let me ask you this morning. Is there anybody out here say, Brother Jim, I'm not saved? I don't know if I'm saved this morning. Would you pray for me? Anybody at all? I'm not saved. Raise your hand up real high. I'm not saved. I've never come to Christ. I've never come to Christ. Anybody at all before we pray? Anybody out here say, Brother Jim, I'm having a hard time in my Christian life. Would you pray for me? Anybody at all? I'm having kind of a hard spot. Would you pray for me? Just lift your hand up. Amen. See your hand. Amen. Anybody else? Amen. I see your hand. Amen. See your hand. God bless you. Anybody else? Amen. Anybody else? All right. Let's pray. Father, God, we pray you take this invitation and use it for thine glory, Lord. God bless this church. Bless this preacher, his wife, God. Meet their needs, Father. Bless these couples that have come before, God. And God, I ask also for these, Lord, that have come and raised their hand, Lord. And then these that have raised their hand, God, said they're having troubles this morning, Lord. It's not time to sit in a seat when they're having troubles. It's time to get at this altar.
Yes.
God, pray that you'd work in their lives. Have the Spirit of God do His job to convict of world or sin, righteous judgment to come. God, they might get the blessing of living a Christian life. Just keep our heads bowed and our eyes closed. I'm going to turn the service over to Brother Easton. Keep our heads bowed and our eyes closed.
Still time to come if you need to come. How the Lord needs some couples. There's some single folks in here, some folks that you're...